CBS Radio. I'm your host, Faisal Zabin, and today we're going to be talking about ancient microbes and ancient biology. These microbes have been co-evolving with our species for thousands of years, influencing our diet, our immune system, our development, our health, and our evolution. And they have acted on us as well. You might have heard of some famous cases of ancient biology, such as Otzi the Iceman, a complete genome that was obtained from a 700,000-year-old horse in Siberia, or Neanderthals. But something to consider is that the microbiomes that were associated with these species act in the same way as microbiomes do on us, influencing a range of different things, including mental health and immunity and our diet. So we could imagine that in the past, the microbiomes associated with those species would have acted on them in a similar way. And over time, this would lead to adaptation between the microbiomes and us or other species that would give rise to potentially large, long-term changes over time, or to reveal significant environmental events that could be detected by analyzing these things. So in this sense, the ancient microbiome offers a way to get a more detailed picture of the life history of ancient populations. So I sat down with an expert in this field, Professor Christina Warner, to talk more about what we can uncover
about our own species evolution
from this amazing field.
Well, my name is Christina Warner, and I work in, I'm an archaeologist, I'm a molecular archaeologist, and I'm really interested in the long-term relationship that humans have had with bacteria, both in their body, through their microbiome, but also in their food.
Professor Warner's group is particularly interested in investigating ancient dental calculus. Dental plaque is an extremely rich harbor of biological information, so I asked her about the relevance of this material and what makes it such a good source of biological information, human or otherwise.
Yeah, so I'm really interested in general in sources of ancient bacteria. How can we find truly ancient bacteria in the archaeological record? And one of the greatest sources is dental calculus, which is a form of calcified dental plaque. It's the only part of your body that actually fossilizes while you're still alive. So it's constantly mineralizing and reforming and growing, kind of like rings of a tree on your teeth. What makes it really unusual is, or at least archaeologically, is that it's extremely abundant. So other forms of preserved ancient bacteria include things like paleofeces, which is also really important and really informative, but as you might imagine, it doesn't preserve very often, which is actually a pretty good thing for us. Otherwise, we'd be very deep in all of that. But it doesn't preserve very well. Dental calculus is different, and that's largely because it does undergo this mineralization process. So by the time a person dies, it doesn't undergo the same decomposition because it's already become semi-fossilized within mineral. And this mineral preserves these bacterial cells and their genetic content for really vast periods of time. So in terms of paleoanthropology, what's the oldest calculus that's ever been described, is about 12 million years old. And that's in a fossil ancestor of the orangutan. But we see it throughout human evolution, and it's very common among primates. Some it's even found in things like dogs and foxes, and a variety of animals make calculus. And so it's really useful. And with respect to humans, it's found in nearly every human population, and it's found on most human individuals. So in that sense, it's a really abundant source of information. And that is important because it allows us to investigate it and ask questions that basically span almost any period of time and cover almost any geographical region.
But there's one problem. DNA can't remain intact or retain its original structure for that long.
And can DNA be recovered from that 12 million-year-old sample?
No one's ever tried, but
no
it's very unlikely.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's very unlikely that DNA could be recovered. We do know that the issue with DNA is that DNA itself can survive for a very long period of time. But in terms of it being an information carrier, it only has four bases. So really, the information that it carries is in the form of the order of those bases. And just through random decay processes, even in permafrost, that DNA starts to break down over time. And once the length of the DNA fragment breaks down to less than 20 base pairs, it loses that information because now these combinations are no longer specific to an organism. And we know that the limit of that, even in permafrost, is about a million years. By a million years, DNA acquires enough just background damage from cosmic radiation that it will be in fragments that are less than 20 base pairs long. So although it's still there, it no longer carries that information. So a million years is thought to be the predicted hard barrier for ancient DNA. The oldest DNA that's ever been recovered successfully is 700,000 years old.
But DNA is not the only way that we can find out about our species' past.
But there's also some really exciting work because so although DNA breaks down kind of relatively quickly, proteins break down much more slowly. And so that's the big hope for understanding human evolution is to go after proteins. So Frieda Welker and Enrico Capellini in Copenhagen have been working on trying to recover the enamel proteome, proteins within enamel, which is the hardest and most durable material that's known. And they've now taken it back and gotten proteins from early Homo. So this might help resolve the early Homo tree, which is pretty exciting. The only problem is there's only, I think, 8 proteins in enamel. So we're a little bit limited in terms of the amount of information we have, but still it's really exciting.
In the recent study that Professor Warner is referring to, the samples obtained were 800,000 years old. And the proteins identified were from dental enamel. But dental calculus is a much richer source of biological information.
So the biomolecules within calculus are very, very rich. So it's the richest source of ancient biomolecules that's known in the archaeological record. So the amount of DNA that's present in calculus is 10 to 1,000 times more than in dentin or bone. And that has to do with the fact that it actually starts with quite a lot of genetic material from the oral microbiome. But it also seems to preserve well over long periods. And it has a really a beautifully diverse proteome as well. So we have lots of bacterial proteins, but importantly, we have lots of host proteins as well. So there's roughly maybe 20 to 40 human proteins that we routinely recover from calculus. Some of them are saliva-related proteins, so salivary amylase, which is an enzyme that breaks down dietary starch that we find in calculus. But we also find a lot of immune proteins in calculus, and we think that has to do with the way that it forms. We find a lot of proteins involved in the innate immune system preserved within calculus, particularly proteins related to the cell type of neutrophil, which is a type of white blood cell.
So then you can infer changes in the immune system, in diet, in evolution, I guess. And there are changes that occur in the co-evolution between the host and the microbiome. So what can you say about these changes? Is there like some kind of chain of like causality, or is that difficult to like disentangle?
Well, that's what we're working out now. So when we first started with this, we weren't sure. There's a lot of challenges when working with ancient bacterial DNA, especially when you have a complex community like a microbiome, because you have hundreds of species and the DNA has all been jumbled and mixed up. And it's tiny in tiny fragments. It's like the world's worst jigsaw puzzle. And so there's a lot of challenges that go with that. So one of the things we've been trying to work on is developing techniques that can help us sort and kind of understand the material that's there. And so we've had a lot of difficulty. Genome reconstruction is really difficult because of this, this system. For ancient pathogens, it's a little bit easier because typically if you have a tuberculosis infection, that's the only mycobacterium that you have. It's the only species of that kind of group that's going to be present. So it's a little bit easier to reconstruct. In the oral microbiome, you have lots of species that are very closely related, many strains even of the same species. So it becomes a little bit harder to separate them. But nevertheless, we've been trying to look a little bit more closely at some of these groups of bacteria that we suspect may have an evolutionary role. So we have a project right now that we're actually going to be submitting to a journal pretty soon, where we looked at the oral microbiome across primates, and then also Neanderthals and humans over a wide span of time. And one of the questions we wanted to know is, what is the core oral microbiome of humans? How far back in time does that go? So how many of these oral microbes do we share with other primates? How has that changed through time, and how might that relate to things that we know changed in terms of diet or habitat? And how different is the oral microbiome of Neanderthals and humans? how different or how did the human microbiome potentially respond to different events within human history, like agriculture or other things. And so we took this very broad evolutionary perspective. And so we've just finished the study. We're about to submit it. We're pretty excited about the results that we found. And we found some really interesting examples of bacterial coevolution with humans in response to, we think, our major shifts in diet that occurred in human evolution. But I can't talk about it yet because it's not through peer review. Okay, we haven't submitted it. But what we're seeing is that in the oral microbiome, we've now identified a core group of about 10 genera of bacteria that that are completely conserved from howler monkeys to humans. So these seem to be really important for the oral microbiome that they've been retained for so long. And they mainly form structural roles in forming the microbiome, which forms in a very ordered manner. So we have typically bacteria that are bridging taxa, that connect different species, that form kind of major some major transportation bacteria, the certain bacteria in the mouth that actually move other bacteria around, because not all bacteria are mobile. So only certain ones are. And so we see some of these are really conserved. So we think this kind of core structure of the oral microbiome is established very early in primate evolution and carried forward. And then we see some other species that only really become closely associated with us as time goes on, including some of the more periodontal disease associated bacteria. And then we see within one of our kind of most ancient groups of bacteria, we see some really interesting genetic changes that happen only with the evolution of Homo that we think is related to diet. So we have a range of features that we think are we can use to understand aspects of our own human evolution.
And microbial evolution as well.
Interesting. Because, well, one of the things that's really fascinating is that, I mean, the human genome evolves very slowly. But microbial genomes can evolve much more rapidly. I mean, you think about their generation time sometimes is as short as 8 hours, whereas ours is 20 years. So it's enormously different generation time. So in terms of their ability to respond very quickly to evolutionary pressures, they're going to show those changes much sooner than humans ever would to those pressures. In addition, bacteria can gain functions horizontally. So they can pick up DNA from the environment. They can very rapidly respond to things. So so we think that some of these changes in human lifestyle and diet will probably have their first visible impact in these oral microbes. And that seems to be what we're seeing in some of these groups.
So changes in our microbiome are a canary in the coal mine for the evolution of our species. Professor Warner and I began talking about how adaptive changes to diet can lead to changes in composition or function of the microbiome as well.
But we are interested in things like starch digestion. So one of the hypotheses is that starch and increasing reliance on both cooking and starchy foods like roots and tubers became important in human evolution. And we see some responses in bacteria in terms of their metabolic capacities that suggest that humans are accessing new food sources.
Something you said earlier hinted at like the question that I'm interested in about human evolution, but specifically like migration and admixture between different hominid species. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering like, well, you said that this clade of bacteria is conserved throughout human evolution. Is it divergent enough to be able to characterize a microbiome as Homo sapiens or Neanderthal or Denisovan?
So that's a great question. And that's something we've been trying really hard to do. It's challenging because what we find is that human and Neanderthal oral microbiome is actually really similar. So in terms of a compositional, in terms of its composition, so it's kind of approximate species composition, they're indistinguishable. However, when you drill down into some of the very specific variants that are found, so these are kind of smaller scale differences, we do see patterns that differentiate humans and Neanderthals. And then we also see some interesting patterns where we see some sharing of variation in places where we know humans and Neanderthals overlapped. And that's something we're really trying to follow up on. It's still a bit tentative, and it's really hard to demonstrate because there's still a lot about the oral microbiome that we don't understand. And so we're still trying to work this out, but we do see some really interesting hints that we may be able to use this to look at these interactions. The oral microbiome is passed down vertically. It's passed down from caregiver to child. And so that's something to keep in mind in terms of how these microbes are passed down.
I think that's like really amazing. It's definitely a challenge, but you know, just being able to reconstruct the history of something like that with so much detail is really an amazing thing.
I agree. I think it's really exciting. And it's also giving us a whole new window on microbial evolution, because we have lots of ideas about how microbes evolve, but most of the work that's been done in microbiology is over really short time periods. I mean, just like over the last 100 yeah. years, you know, but once you have authentic ancient microbes that you can recover from a kind of time capsule, which is what calculus is, the whole history opens up to you. Thousands of, tens of thousands of years open up to you. So we, in our current study, we have Neanderthals up to 100,000 years old from which we've recovered really well preserved in the sense that authentic oral microbial DNA. And that allows us to look at evolution that's happened over this time scale, because we can either radiocarbon date or date them using other methods. And then we can go through time and try to look at how these different groups of bacteria evolved and changed. That's pretty exciting.
And on top of investigating ancient DNA, Professor Warner's group is also interested in proteins. So we discussed what kind of proteins can be found, as well as the technological advancements that make research like this possible.
But we're also looking at proteins too. So in calculus, we're looking at both DNA, and our focus right now on DNA is largely microbial, because that's extremely rich. We can recover human mitochondrial genomes from calculus. We've shown that. We've had a lot more trouble getting whole human genomes. And I think it's a technological problem we haven't quite overcome. But when it comes to proteins, we get a kind of broader diversity. So we get bacterial proteins, we get a lot more human proteins, but we also get dietary proteins. And that's something we're also trying to boost the signal of. So right now, the dietary proteins are low enough abundance that we sometimes see them, we sometimes don't. They're really at the limits of our detection. And so we're trying to boost that signal, because in some cases we're finding really spectacular proteins that are letting us know, giving us information about whole, you know, groups of foods that are otherwise totally archaeologically invisible. So in one case, for example, a lot of my work has been on milk. Milk is very protein rich, and so we do tend to find these, and it preserves very well in calculus, and we think that's because these milk proteins are calcium binding. But there's been a big question about when did milk start, and how did people start milking, and how did dairying spread, and why is it that, you know, humans ever started drinking animal milk, considering that the ancestral state for humans is to be lactose intolerant? So how did this even begin? And then you have major kind of centers of dairying around the world, and they've all kind of taken a different trajectory. And you still have places in the world like Mongolia where people do not have any genetic adaptations to dairy consumption. They can't digest lactose genetically, and yet their entire subsistence economy is based on milk products. So how does that work, and how did that come to be? And so this is an interesting question that combines a lot of these interests, because we're looking at trying to document the spread of milk archaeologically by looking for these milk proteins in calculus. But we're also doing work with the modern gut microbiome and trying to understand how the gut microbiome might be adaptive and might be aiding in preventing lactose intolerance. So these are kind of some of the questions we're trying to put together as well. So
technology like opens up this work, right? So
absolutely.
Techniques like metagenomics and next generation sequencing.
It was a huge game changer, and it's the only reason we're able to do any of this. There's been a major revolution in the biological sciences, molecular biology, with the arrival of high throughput sequencing, and also with computational advances too. So the vast expansion of computing, those two things needed to happen to make this work. All the work that I'm describing now would not have been possible before 2010. So it's a really recent availability of these technologies. So we went from being able to generate a few hundred sequences of DNA per day to a few billion sequences of DNA per day, virtually overnight around the year 2010. And that has completely changed the field. And it's really what took the field of ancient DNA from a kind of boutique small branch of genetics into modern genomics. And at this point, we can largely generate data sets of the same size and complexity as modern samples. The only thing that we're a bit troubled by is that our DNA is shorter, just because it's been fragmented. And so that's kind of our leading challenge at the moment. But in terms of everything else, we can generate extremely high quality data.
Before I end the show, I want you to imagine yourself as an ancient hominid, living maybe 7,000, 100,000 years ago, walking home after a hunt through the forest, and all of a sudden you're attacked by a snake or a saber-toothed tiger, something deadly. Your family can't find out about your death. Maybe this is before the development of language, so no one knows about what happened to you. There's no record of your life, except for your body. And for thousands of years, you lay there, preserved in maybe what's now ice. And several dozen thousand years later, some researchers stumble upon your body. And maybe up until 20 years ago, they might do some skeletal analysis, try to figure out what kind of person you were.
And then more recently, we have the power to do genome-wide scans.
Okay, you might have had blue eyes. You're predisposed to some illness.
But given the technological advancements of the past decade, and combined with the work that Professor Warner showcased here, not only can we find out about what you look like, but through analysis of your microbiome and the proteins present in your dental calculus, we can figure out what disease you might have had, what you ate, what you wore, and how your general health might have been.
With this information, you can paint a more detailed life history of this person than was ever possible before.
And I think that's the really amazing thing, and that's what makes this work so fascinating.